So at the beginning of the semester, we talked about using regression as a descriptive technique, and now we're going to talk about doing inference for regression. And to begin with, I just want you to remember about least squares regression, or sometimes this is also called simple linear regression. I had this example that we were talking about, which was data from rail trails in Massachusetts. And it was about the average temperature in degrees Fahrenheit against the volume, which was the number of people on the rail trail. And so we were trying to see if we could predict the number of people who were on the trail based on the average temperature of the day. And we were using linear regression as a descriptive technique. So maybe we would try and fit the best line through the data, and that would allow us to describe the data, like if we were talking to someone over the telephone, by using the form, y equals mx plus b. As long as you understand about slope and intercept form, I could tell you what the relationship is between these two variables pretty simply without having to give you all the data. So we have an explanatory variable and a response variable in least squares regression. In this case, our explanatory variable was the average temperature, and our response variable was the volume on the trail. And then we could write out the regression equation as y hat, or maybe volume hat, is equal to 99.6 plus 4.8 times the average temp. And that hat over volume or over y means that it's a predicted value. It's not the exact value, it's whatever the predicted value is on the line. So if we were looking at this picture and we wanted to make a prediction of how many people were on the rail trail when the temperature was 40 degrees, we could just go up to the line and find the predicted value right there on the line. And we could have plugged in 40 degrees into our equation to find that prediction as well. So that would be our best guess for the number of people who are on the rail trail. But when we're doing statistics, we're not always just thinking about our particular best guess, we're thinking about parameters that are out there in the population. So when we're doing simple linear regression, we have population parameters and we have sample statistics. And the population parameters are things like beta zero, which is the intercept, and beta one, which is the slope, and epsilon, which is the residual. That's the difference between the real and the predicted value. So if we went back to our picture, we could think about the residual for a particular point. Maybe we would think about this point way up here. We've got our real value, which is the point. This is the observed value. And then we would need to figure out the predicted value. So we could go down to the line, and that would be our predicted value. And then the difference between these two things, that's the residual, which we often denote with epsilon. So those are our main parameters. And then when we're thinking about our sample statistics, our best guess from the data that we actually have, we've got B0, that's our sample intercept, and B1, which is our sample slope. There's no epsilon here because we've got the y hat, that's the predicted value. That's just the point right on the line. It doesn't have to be perfect. So we're going to do inference for the slope. We're going to do both a confidence interval and a hypothesis test. Our general format for a confidence interval is a point estimate plus or minus a critical value times a standard error. And in the case of linear regression, our point estimate is B1. Our critical value is going to be from a t distribution, and then we're going to need to think about the standard error. And then for a hypothesis test, we're always doing our point estimate minus our null value over the standard error. And in this case, that would be B1, our point estimate for the slope minus our null slope value over the standard error, and that would be a t value that we would look in the t-distribution to find a p-value. So this is for confidence intervals, and this is for hypothesis tests. And the question, as always, is how do we find that standard error? So I'll go further into this in the next video.